Welcome to episode 6 of Final Fantasy IX Translation Analysis, the long-running series where I compare, contrast, and comment on the various differences between Final Fantasy IX's English and Japanese scripts. In episode 5, we met our fifth party member, so it's only fitting that in episode 6, we'll be getting to know the sixth and weirdest member of the team, and we'll also get our first glimpse of the game's fabulous main villain. So strap yourselves in, cause we're in for a ride that'll take us all the way to Bermessia. After leaving Lindblom, Zidane and the others stop by Kuzmarsch and meet Quina, whose gender is of course kept ambiguous throughout the whole game, something that is easier to achieve in Japanese, since the language is heavily context-based and avoids pronoun usage more often than not. But when characters do use a pronoun to refer to Quina, it's always gender-neutral ones like koits or aits, rather than kare, he, or kanojo, she. The English translation's solution to this was not the most elegant in my opinion, cause, you know, it feels pretty weird to see something like this in a dialogue box. Like, how are the characters even saying that? S-he? S/he? Not to mention that when it's a possessive form, they abandon gender neutrality altogether and just say his, rather than his/her. So yeah, it's a bit messy. But of course, the game came out in the year 2000, and back then it obviously wasn't as common to use they/them as a gender neutral pronoun, so that option probably didn't occur to the translator either. But we're in 2022 now, so that is what I'll be using to refer to Quina, and how I would expect a new English translation to address the character. Anyway, last time I pointed out how even after 5 party members, they all still use unique first-person pronouns to refer to themselves. Quina, however, breaks that streak as they use the same pronoun as Freya, namely, watashi. However, there is still a difference since Quina says it in katakana, which is probably used to emphasize their foreignness. See, Quina is an oddball no matter the language, of course, but their speech in Japanese gives us a hint as to the kind of oddball they're supposed to be. Katakana is a Japanese alphabet usually reserved for foreign loanwords, and Quina employs it relatively often, not just when saying watashi, but for other words as well, and especially for the verbal tic of their race, the Ku tribe, who say aru at the end of every sentence. This is actually how stereotypical Chinese characters tend to speak in anime and manga. It's supposed to mimic Chinese speech in the way that words sometimes end with a sound similar to aru in Mandarin Chinese and Beijing dialect. And China is also well known for its cuisine, and in Japan in particular, it is heavily associated with cooking and restaurants, which is why the Ku tribe is composed of gourmands, as they're called in-game, being clearly inspired by Chinese chefs. I mean, just look at Quan.
Bah! Oh, sorry, wrong picture. This is actually a concept art of Quina.
This is Quan, Vivi's foster grandpa in all his Chineseness. And then we have Quail, Quina's master, who asks Zidane to let Quina travel with him, as the student seems satisfied to simply eat frogs from the Kuzmarsh the two of them inhabit, which prompts the master to say,
Quina, you in darkness, need some light.
In Japanese, this line is as follows.
ここの帰るだけで満足してるとは、お前はまだまだ食の道は遠いあるね。
More literally translated, this reads,
If you're satisfied just by eating the frogs in this place, you're still a long way from the 食の道.
食の道 literally means the way of eating, or the way of food. In this line, they didn't really translate the term to English, but in future cases, it's translated as the way of gourmand, which appears to be an exalted state of mastery that all members of the Ku tribe aspired to. Quina's quest to reach this state seems to me to deliberately mirror how a Chinese Taoist or Buddhist might seek enlightenment. In their own way, Quina is on a spiritual quest to uncover a deeper truth about life and in the process attain a sort of mastery over it and themselves. Much later, a hidden optional scene, which includes the manifest spirit of Vivi's grandpa Quan, gives us a glimpse of what the end goal of this quest for the way of gourmand might look like. incidentally, when Vivi mentions his grandpa to Quail, Quail calls Kwan a henkutsujiji, which is translated as bigot, but bigoted old geezer would have been more accurate and complete, since it suggests that Quail is younger than Kwan, which makes sense as we later find out that Kwan was actually Quail's master, just like how Quail is now Queena's master. A fun little piece of trivia is that Queena's most iconic ability, Frog Drop, not only looks like the Frog Squash ability used by Frog in Chrono Trigger, but in Japanese, these two abilities are actually written in the exact same manner, Kairu Otoshi. It was only in English that they were translated differently in each game, so we can say that Final Fantasy IX not only has references to previous Final Fantasy games, but also to Chrono Trigger, which is pretty cool. Anyway, with the addition of Queena, our party of four head towards Bermessia, but before we get there, we can stop by Northgate, where there's a completely optional and easily missable scene that juxtaposes the characters of Queena and Freya. Perhaps precisely because it's totally optional and missable, its translation probably could have been a little better. So let's look at it line by line, going over the English first and then the Japanese, followed by a more literal translation.
Queena does whatever he feels like doing. I must learn from his ways. Maybe I should follow this Queena's example and live more spontaneously.
I don't think it's intentional, Freya. あいつの場合、深く受け取らない方がいいと思うけどな。 When it comes to Queena, I think it's best if you don't read too much into their behavior.
No, if I had done as I pleased, I would have been. 嫌なことは嫌、いいものはいい。 素直に言えていれば、今頃、私は… If I had been more honest and upfront about what I wanted and didn't want, things would be different now.
Zidane, this flower tastes good!
See what I mean?
But still… いや、羨ましい限りじゃ… I'm just envious is all.
Zidane telling Freya that Queena's spontaneity isn't intentional feels a little off to me because, of course it's not intentional. If Queena was deliberately and consciously acting all spontaneous, it wouldn't really be true spontaneity now, would it? So him telling Freya not to read too much into this weirdo's behavior seems more natural to me. And Freya's lines afterwards feel a bit more revealing in Japanese, with her outright admitting that she envies Queena's candid and unrestrained nature, and that if she had been more honest with herself about her own likes and dislikes, her wants and needs, she might be in a different place right now, and of course, she might still have Fratley by her side. I'm not saying you can't infer this from the English translation of the scene, you can, but I do feel the Japanese gives us a slightly deeper insight into Freya's feelings here. Speaking of her feelings, she once again expresses what's going on in her heart when we arrive at Bermessia, and there's also a slight difference between the two versions in this monologue of hers. In English she says,
I can't believe I'm here. I am no longer the selfish child I was 5 years ago. The time has come to serve my kingdom as a Bermessian Dragon Knight once again.
In Japanese she goes,
懐かしい. How nostalgic.
Or,
how I've missed this place. 私もあれから随分と変わった. I've changed so much since I left.
And for this final line, I think I'll let Freya's Japanese voice actress do the honors.
今、私の竜騎士としての力が試される時が来たのじゃ.
And now the time has come for me to put my prowess as a Dragon Knight to the test.
The difference I was alluding to is of course that she doesn't really put herself down in Japanese. In English, she says she used to be a selfish child, but in Japanese, she just says she's changed a lot since the days when she still lived in Bermessia. After this brief scene, we get a proper introduction to the city of Bermessia with the usual title appearing on screen. You know, I've always loved this title. Realm of Eternal Rain just sounds so cool, even if it is completely made up. Because the Japanese title is
Ao no Oto, Bermessia.
This can be roughly translated as the Blue Royal Capital, Bermessia. Although, to make it sound fancier and more poetic, they would probably go with the Azure Royal Capital, or just the Azure Capital. At the end of Disc 1, we get to meet two significant antagonists whom we'll face in battle multiple times, the first being Beatrix, the general of Alexandria's main forces. Here's how Freya introduces her in English.
The cold-blooded knight who knows no mercy.
In Japanese, she does literally call her cold-blooded as well, and the word is exactly the same, being composed of the two kanji for cold and blood. But she also uses an idiomatic expression that is pretty amusing. Nakuko mo damaru. Nak means crying, ko means child, mo means even, and damaru means to shut up. As you might be able to guess from that, this is an expression that roughly means being intimidating enough to quieten a crying child. That's how scary Beatrix is. However, before we get a first-hand taste of Beatrix's overwhelming power, we're introduced to none other than our main villain, Kuja. He refers to himself with Boku, just like Vivi, and speaks as theatrically in Japanese as he does in English, with the most sophisticated vocabulary out of probably all the characters. In the ensuing dialogue, Bran calls the Burmesians Nezumi, the simplest word for rats, but Kuja uses the more specific term Dobunezumi, meaning brown rats, or as they are more commonly known, street rats or sewer rats. So we could say that Kuja is more or less using an ethnic slur here, you know, to let us know right away how much of a dick he is. But he also shows us his verbal wit, as seen in this line, especially the Japanese version. In English he says,
"So you see, it's too late. The king has already turned tail and fled."
The Japanese version of the line reads,
"Mojidori, shippo maite nigete itayo. O-sama mo issho ni ne." The rats literally turned tail and fled, including the king.
He specifically says "mojidori," which means literally, because being rats, they actually have tails to turn as they flee. Oh, you Kuja. But for now, he remains mostly in the background, letting Beatrix be the one to kick her butts instead. But not before she brags with,
"I once killed 100 knights single-handedly."
In Japanese, this is actually a nickname or title that Beatrix claims to have earned. Shout out to any Blade of the Immortal fans, since it is the exact same title attributed to its protagonist Manji, Hyakuningiri, meaning killer or slayer of 100 people. Incidentally, when used in a slangy manner, this expression can also mean someone who's gone to bed with 100 or simply a lot of people. Isn't it curious and charming how in both Japanese and English, the verb to slay is used so creatively? Anyway, Beatrix then informs us that,
"You're no match for me."
If this was a subtitled anime, many of you would probably recognize her line in Japanese, because it's the classic anime phrase you've heard a million times before about how we're 100 years too early to challenge her. Hyakunen hayai! Then, after we're thoroughly trounced, she asks,
"Isn't there anyone who is worthy of facing me?"
In Japanese, this line isn't phrased as a question and reads more like,
"So this country too is devoid of anyone that might satisfy my fighting spirit."
Finally, Beatrix and Bran leave, and Kuja is left alone with our defeated heroes, with his eyes resting intently on Zidane as he murmurs,
"This boy could become a problem."
After what we learn about the relation later on, I've always felt that this reaction to Zidane feels a little too subdued and impersonal on Kuja's part, but now I think that's partly because of the way it was translated, since in Japanese Kuja says,
"Mondai wa kochi no shounen da na."
Rather than "could become," he outright says that this boy is the problem, with the implication being that he's the real problem, or at least a bigger problem than the rats that went on to hide in Clara. He still calls him boy, so it still feels somewhat strangely distant and detached, but I guess that's just the writers trying not to spoil us of the major revelations and plot twists that would come two discs later. And speaking of discs, we've reached the end of the first one, and we still don't have a full party, meaning we still have more pronouns and speech patterns to look forward to. But not just yet, as next time we return to Garnet and Steiner to check on them and see what they've been up to. Getting to the end of Disc 1 feels like a small milestone that I'm glad to have reached. If you've enjoyed the journey so far and look forward to seeing more, then please help out the channel by liking, subscribing, clicking the bell icon, and if possible, sharing these videos with other Final Fantasy fans that might be interested in this kind of stuff. I'd really appreciate it. That's all for now. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time, Chocobros.